Yeah, well, when I fell, I bumped smack into this super hot chick, and I...
What? Let's go after her! Show me where she is!
Welcome to the Weekly Diranto. The rules are simple. I pick three shows connected by a theme. I watch the first episode of each show, and then pit them against each other in a battle. There can be only one winner. The winner is the show I'd be most likely to continue watching. This week, our subject is Uberworld. They're a Japanese rock band, and they've been playing their unique style of alternative Japanese pop rock for the last 19 years. If you watch anime or listen to Japanese radio, you're probably quite familiar with their songs. Here are just a few highlights of their work. A good number of Uberworld's songs have been used as opening themes or promotional songs. This leads us to this week's selection of shows. Puzzle & Dragon's Cross, Blue Exorcist, and The Promised Neverland. The connection here is that the first opening theme of these three shows is performed by Uberworld. So without further ado, get ready for the next battle! Puzzle & Dragon's Cross. Puzzle & Dragon's Cross is based on a popular Match 3 game called Puzzle & Dragons. The show starts with some military gruff types talking in the war room, while Uberworld drowns them out. Gee, I hope they weren't saying anything important because I can't hear them. Dragonoids. Looks like some kind of dragon is being attacked by the military. Hey, I kind of feel bad for the dragon here. Okay, you're looking at all this cool shit. Dragon, like, getting attacked by tanks. Busting through the walls of buildings? All this military shit? Like, just keep in mind that this is the anime for Candy Crush Saga with dragons. It's the anime for Candy Crush Saga, essentially. A dragon flies across the night sky, and we're sitting too close to the TV. Make sure you're watching this in a well-lit room and don't sit too close to the TV. I'm like, less than a meter away from the TV. Sue me. A weird boy is riding the dragon with generic mascot character on his back, holding a portable radio. A meteor soars overhead. We found it. Follow that shit. They touch down on land, and the weird boy dismisses his dragon.
Oh, wonderful. Look at this sunny weather. Look at this status quo that will get fucked by the end of the episode.
This is our main character, Ace. I'll be kind and ignore that he's a plagiarized Spike from Ape Escape. His special ability is that he can see the best ingredients, which is just... okay, that's a stand power I'd expect someone like Gordon Ramsay to have.
Seriously, is this guy's special ability, like, I can see the freshest ingredients? Yeah, bitch, it's called using your fucking eyes. If you've ever gone grocery shopping, you look at one tomato, you look at the other tomato, you're like, this one's better. It's not fucking rocket science.
Creepy Boy's trying to find the meteor that fell using his Pokemon Lapras. I mean, his water dragon. Whatever fell didn't land in the ocean, that's for sure.
Back in your Pokeball.
Poor little kitty stuck up in a tree. Ace returns with the Pussycatto and bumps into a girl named Haru, the cat's owner. The girl wants to be a dragon caller, think like a Pokemon trainer except for dragons? Boring military types talk about boring military things, who cares?
Remember, all this, like, militaristic shit? Candy Crush Saga the anime. Just keep that in mind.
Ace and Haru have a quiet, intimate moment with ice cream by the seafront. Yada yada, Ace finds egg, Haru gets the hots for creepy dragon caller boy, etc, etc. Ace tries to bring the egg home, much to his mother's disappointment. I mean, come on, you don't know where it's been. You could catch something. But this is an anime protagonist. You think he's gonna do what his mum tells him to? Fuck no. Oh hey, it's a dragon. It's the dragon from the beginning of the episode. Looks pissed. The episode drags on, doesn't it? Drags on? Dragon? Military, blah blah blah, obvious bad guys. At least they have the decency to evict folks before they destroy their homes. We can scrub through all this dragon military stuff. Hotshot dragon weird boy Lance is all like, I could do this with my arms tied behind my back while I was wearing a blindfold. And then Ace is like, hey show off, shut up before I rearrange your face with my shoes. Turns out this Lance is a good guy or something. He summons a dragon to fight the other dragon. Download Puzzle and Dragons today. This anime sponsored by Puzzle and Dragons. Boom, that dragon's fucking dead.
Armor job ready!
Oh look, medallions! Make sure you get Mum and Dad to buy all the medallions for you, plus shipping and tax.
Charming! Japania!
The episode ends abruptly with no warning. Oh thank goodness, I thought my brain was going to melt. Can we move on?
Blue Exorcist.
Blue Exorcist, or Aoi no Exorcist, is an anime based on the work of mangaka Kazue Kato. The source material makes heavy use of biblical references, which is always welcome. Gives this a Harry Potter meets Bleach kind of feel. Okay, spoilers, I'm kind of breaking the rules here. I have seen 3 episodes of this show. When I say seen, I mean listened to while doing chores, cooking, tidying up, washing up, and drying clothes. So nothing really soaked in. I'm starting to think that it's Blue Exorcist's fault and not my own, because giving it another chance for the weekly Diranto, nothing soaked in. Again. The show starts with some religious men trying to exorcise a demon, but it results in all of their deaths. So this is the world our story takes place in, one where demons and gods and religion is tangibly real.
Blue Exorcist! Oh, listen to that fucking saxophone!
Our main character, Ren, rescues a pigeon that's being attacked by some thug bullies. Even though it was for good reasons, he's scolded by his foster father, the local priest and man of God, Father Fujimoto. Why can't you be more like your perfect younger brother, Yukio, who always gets straight A's and never misses a lesson and just got accepted into Super Talented Guy Academy? Just so also happens that the younger brother is a super talented medic, is there anything he can't do? Probably, but we don't get to see it in this episode though. Oh good, this tender moment is ruined by 2 random goons showing Ren that the nearby shopping mall is hiring part-timers. Speaking of part-timers, that's some good timing on this part, you see. My washing is done, so I need to go hang it up on the line. Be right back. So after a bunch of light-hearted stuff I just skipped for your benefit, a little girl is getting attacked by a demon of some kind that only she and nearby Ren can see. Ren chases after the little demon thing and loses the job at the shopping mall in the process by causing property damage. So I did you a favor by skipping forward to like 6 minutes. After Ren laments the loss of his job for 9,000 hours, he returns home to find the little girl he saved and her father at the monastery to thank him for helping her. The father is clueless about the invisible ghost demons, as are most people. Ren is goaded into a fight by the bullshit thug bullies from before, but now the bullshit thug bully has black space pus coming out of his face.
Kick his ass!
What the hell you want about me?
Yeah!
But never diss my brother!
Damn fucking straight!
Ren gets into a fight, turns blue dabba-dee-dabba-dye.
Boom! Shonen transformation, motherfuckers!
Fujimoto turns up to exorcise the demon-possessing bullshit thug bully and lays a bombshell on us. Ren is the son of, can you guess, Satan. That's right, Satan's son! So Ren can see demons because he's the son of a demon. I'd have probably really enjoyed this if I was like 16 or something. I can certainly see why this series gets the praise it does, but it's so apparent it's been, shall we say, influenced by its peers. It's not half bad, but half bad is more bad than not bad, if that makes any sense.
Far as shonen anime goes, this ticks the boxes.
The Promised Neverland.
Now for some fresh meat on the weekly Diranto. This is the very succulent Promised Neverland. It's a 2016 manga series that has only just recently received an animated adaptation. This prime rib of a show ran from January to March of this year, so it's pretty much only finished airing. From what I've heard about it, nothing has been butchered in the story transfer process. The second season is coming next year in 2020. Yakusoku no Neverland, or The Promised Neverland, is, well, quite something actually.
Little bunny.
It begins with the main 3 characters, Emma, the orange-haired girl, Norman, the grey-haired boy, and Ray, the black-haired boy, staring through a barred gate and wondering what's on the other side. They're but a few of the 38 little kids cut off from the outside world.
So are they like prisoners or something? Because we've got barred gates, we've got numbers branded on their necks. Makes me wonder if they're meant to be like prisoners or something.
Their mother, Isabella, runs the orphanage and raises the whole lot of kids by herself, providing them with food, education, and play. They're told never to venture off the orphanage grounds because it's dangerous outside. But are those bars protecting them? Or are the kids simply like battery hens, raised in isolation and solitude? The children only get to leave when they are adopted by a new family, and the first episode is set on the day that the delightful young girl, Connie, will be leaving to meet her new family. Oh, she'll be leaving, all right. We see what the typical day for these children entails. Breakfast, education, and play. They get free range of the entire grounds to run, play, and graze to their heart's content, provided they are in bed by their curfew. After a long day of playing tag, the evening draws in, and with it, a sense of foreboding and dread. Mama Isabella takes Connie to meet her new family at the gate that leads out of the grounds.
Where are they gonna take Connie? Where are they taking little Connie? Is she like gonna go to get turned into Soylent Green or something?
Soylent Green is people!
Almost instantly, Isabella seems to take on a different personality.
I can't help but feel extremely uncomfortable right now.
Emma and Norman discover that Connie has left her beloved stuffed bunny behind, which leads them to run after her, breaking their curfew. What happens is a very sudden and intense tonal shift.
What are they about to see that's going to make them fucking uncomfortable? What am I about to see that's going to make me uncomfortable?
As the two look around the gate area for Connie.
The show is just making me, like, extremely uncomfortable. The camera angles, the cutting, the editing, the lighting, the subject matter, everything about this show is really making my skin crawl.
But what they find in the back of the truck is something they were not prepared to see, and neither was I.
What are they gonna find in the truck? I don't wanna know. So what's it gonna be? What's it gonna be?
Connie is dead.
Oh fuck, she's dead.
With a rose crudely stuffed into her chest.
Stabbed right through the heart, what the fuck?
She clearly died in a horrific and painful way, her eyes wide open and her face contorted. Before Emma and Norman can even make sense of the situation, a voice calls out. They've been heard, but by who? They scramble under the truck and are then horrified to find that the voices calling out do not belong to humans.
The fuck?
Some form of alien or nightmarish creatures is selling off human children as food to be eaten as an expensive delicacy by the bourgeoisies.
Next thing they'll be breeding us like cattle for food.
Although noticed by the aliens, Emma and Norman escape.
Fucking hell. The orphanage is a farm to create high quality food for some sort of alien creature. Damn, this is dark.
However, they foolishly left the stuffed bunny behind. Isabella is aware that at least one of the children saw what happened, and who knows what punishment could ensue. Back at the orphanage, Norman and Emma start devising a scheme to get all the kids out of the orphanage before any more have to die. This was a roller coaster ride. Really?
You're just gonna end it like that?
Puzzle and Dragons Cross. I'm across just thinking about how much of my life I wasted watching this. It's a lovely show with some gorgeous colour use, but the military stuff kind of just turns me off. It has a great sense of humour and some wonderful designs, but I think I'm far too old to get anything out of that show. Blue Exorcist I've given so many chances, and again I struggle to feel what it's going for. It's so shonen that when you look up shonen in the dictionary, there's a picture of Blue Exorcist. I'm sure I'll give this show even more chances in the future until it finally gels with me, but alas, today is not the day. Promised Neverland touched me in ways I never want to be touched again. I was beaten, crushed, and spat on by this show. It's a show that's filled with the distinct feeling of defeat at every turn, but morbid curiosity means you just can't look away. I don't think the result will surprise anyone, but I'm ready to give my verdict.
This game's winner is
The Promised Neverland. absolutely no contest. Puzzle and Dragons might have appealed to me as a young teenager, and Blue Exorcist certainly carries a lot of promise. But in terms of what I want to watch immediately, The Promised Neverland. No question. This is the first time since Wolverine that a show has just been a clear winner. This show feels like a really good American horror story premise, like something out of a Barker novel. An orphanage where children are raised like free-range farm animals as food for a race of disturbing nightmare creatures. Not even Stephen King, nose deep in a jar of cocaine, could have come up with this. So which would you have crowned the winner? Puzzle and Dragons and its childish charm? Blue Exorcist and its Son of Satan shonen action? Or The Promised Neverland and its chilling dinge-fuck hopelessness? Remember to cast your vote in the cards and share your choice down in the comments below. This has been Real Asia, you've been watching the Weekly Diaranto, and I'll see you next time.